I'm happy to introduce this film interview with Dr. Martin Lings about his writings and his lectures on William Shakespeare. It's very fortunate that we were able to have from someone like Dr. Lings an interview in which he candidly discusses his lifelong involvement with Shakespeare, which began as a student at Oxford University in 1929 and 1930. Dr. Lings describes for us in the film that he changed his major to study with the famous C.S. Lewis. It was there at Oxford University that Dr. Lings, after seeing his first Shakespeare play, Othello, was so deeply moved by that experience that it began a lifelong curiosity for him about both the spiritual impact of Shakespeare and what that meaning had for him as a person. How Dr. Lings became involved with the works of William Shakespeare is now told in this filmed interview. Dr. Lings explains to us, relates to us in a very personal way, his own spiritual search, how it began and when it began. And as it took flight and as it deepened, he was at that time a professor at the University of Cairo, teaching Shakespeare and producing Shakespeare's plays. His sensitivity to spirituality and religion and the esoteric meanings behind things made apparent to him that William Shakespeare was no ordinary author. He was a man, as Dr. Lings described, who was able to write from a transcendent consciousness through which his work was such a great piece of art that Dr. Lings describes as sacred art. So let's watch the film of Dr. Lings now, in which he explores his lifelong scholarship and interest with William Shakespeare and his own personal life journey, which coincided with his study and learning about Shakespeare. Well, nice to see you, Dr. Lings. The first question I think that our audience would be most interested in is to describe your early acquaintance with William Shakespeare from your Oxford University experience and the first revelation of something a little more profound in Shakespeare's works.
Well, that is a question which interests me, and as a beginning, the first experience I had was this. I was a student at Oxford, at Magdalen College, and I was interested in art and poetry. By the time I left school, I was brought up as an Anglican, and we used to have to go to chapel on Sundays twice a day and three times a week also. But by the time I was a student, I'd stopped going to church. And I didn't really, I just prayed every night. I never stopped doing that. But I didn't know what to think, or I couldn't swallow the things, the religion that was presented to me as an Anglican. You see, it meant, being an Anglican meant that I had, it was not high church, and I had no knowledge of Christian saints or Christian mysticism whatsoever. But when I was a student, I was interested. Looking back, I see that I made a religion of art, of beauty. as it were, for myself, because every man really must have a religion, and if the official religion doesn't satisfy them, well, he will make a religion of something else. And I had made, it seems to me, looking back, a religion of beauty for myself, especially centered on nature, on virgin nature, and on the arts. And I found at Oxford a man, a student of my age, who had exactly the same ideas as myself, also brought up as an Anglican. And he had been a historian, and I had a classical education, but C.S. Lewis, who later on became famous, was the English tutor at Magdalen College, our college, and we both changed over, he from history and I from English, I from classics, to take a final degree in English as Lewis's pupils. And Lewis himself recognized the greatness of Shakespeare, of course, but he wasn't particularly interested in Shakespeare, as I and my friend were. And I was interested in acting, and so was he, so was my friend. We were both, we were successively presidents of the Magdalen College Dramatic Society, and my friend acted in the what is called OUDS, that is Oxford University Dramatic Society, it's known as OUDS. In those days, the male parts were played by the best students found, but all the female parts were played by the best professional actresses in London.
Oh, that's interesting.
And I had to read, one of the plays I had to read specially to take my degree in English was Othello. And I hadn't yet read the play. And I thought I'll go and see it first, because the OUDS, the Oxford University Dramatic Society, were doing Othello that year. And, the part of Desdemona was played by Peggy Ashcroft, who was, at that time, she was just beginning her career. This was just over 70 years ago, This took place. And the part of Othello was played by the son of an actor who later on went onto the stage, a man called Valentine Dial. His father was quite well known. He himself became quite well known as an actor. But the most outstanding performance, to my mind, later on, was an actress, also a very good actress, called Martita Hunt, who played the part of Emilia, the wife of Iago, which is a very important part. Now, Othello I didn't know what was going to happen, so I hadn't read the play, so I saw it quite fresh. It's possibly the most heart-rending of Shakespeare's plays, of all Shakespeare's plays. And it has a simplicity which Hamlet and King Lear have not got. I'm not saying that this is anything against Hamlet and King Lear, because the complexity, the extreme complexity of Hamlet is as fascinating in its own way as the simplicity in Othello. But in Othello, you have a perfect marriage. One is persuaded from the very beginning that they are an example of an ideal match. You have a man who is the personification of evil, bent on destroying this marriage. And you have a fourth character who is amazingly devoted, the wife of the third character, amazingly devoted to the woman of the couple, to Desdemona.
Now, at the first seeing of that drama,
yes,
you didn't have quite the appreciation of those relationships.
The first scene of the drama, you discover the villainy of the third character I mentioned, who is the personification of evil. And in fact, as regards that person, we're looking back, one could say that the allegorical meaning is almost stronger in one's impression than the literal meaning. The literal meaning is that Iago is the enemy of every man. I use the word every man in the sense of the play Every Man, the late medieval play Every Man, who represents every chief character in Shakespeare could be called every man, as I say in my book, because he represents man as a whole. Does Iago, at the end of the play, do you think of him as the enemy of every man or as the enemy of mankind, mm-hmm. that is, Satan, which is the allegorical significance of Iago in Shakespeare. And I think that one leaves the theatre looking upon Iago as the enemy of mankind. However, that's a question which doesn't need to be answered. But I was spellbound by this performance of the play. The men's parts, I say, were well acted. The women's parts were superbly acted. A man who did Othello did a very... And they always had one of the leading London producers. The play, it would be difficult to... It must have been in 1930 or 31, this performance. And I know that the next performance of ours was Romeo and Juliet, and Peggy Ashcroft played the part of Juliet in that. And that was produced by John Gielgud. He came from London to produce that part.
How did you feel the first time walking as a student at Oxford out of that performance of Othello, which, as you say, should have been heart-wrenching? What was your feeling?
The performance was heart-rending, but for the next few days I was plunged into an extraordinary state of happiness that I had never known before, and it was puzzling. How could this tragedy produce this effect? Now, when you analyze Othello, when you begin to analyze Othello at all, you see that Shakespeare has overall given the impression of harmony in this play. Literally speaking, it might seem to be a triumph of evil over good. In the next to the last scene, which is played in total darkness sometimes in the streets of Cyprus, Iago says, "This is the night which either makes me or foredoes me quite here," meaning simply altogether. Meaning in Shakespearean English, "This is the night that either makes me or foredoes me quite." And how is it that after this heart-rending tragedy, I felt this extraordinary happiness for 3 days about it lasted. And I didn't have an explanation of that, but just about that time, my mother sent me a book called Keats and Shakespeare. And I read this book with the greatest interest. And I saw that Keats, and I loved the poetry of Keats. Next to Shakespeare, he was one of my favorite poets, I would say. And Keats had seen that Shakespeare's plays succeed in portraying or in giving an impression of what one might call the harmony of the universe. Play after play among the great plays succeeds in doing that. And I realized that this was the truth. And this explained the happiness that I had felt. That extended my conception of religion to a certain extent. I will say to a certain extent, because it was clearly very limited, and I had a new concept of art, I might say, sacred art, the significance of art, which was to give that impression of the harmony of things, one might say. However, later on I was still groping along with these ideas, and then I came to read in the 3 or 4 years later, the books of René Guénon, which changed my life completely. And to give you just a synopsis of what I learned from, one of the things I learned from these books was to do with religion, that all the great religions of the world, and there is no need to mention their names, everybody knows what they are, they are all equally from God and equally true. And they could be likened to points on the circumference of a circle. But each of these points has a radius leading to the center. That center being God himself. And the nearer they approach the center, these radii, the nearer they are to each other. And I realized that my place was on one of these radii. Each religion has what one might call an esoteric path leading to God. And I realized that my place was on one of these radii. Now, I didn't know which. I very quickly became a Roman Catholic. But I was heading for India, because at that time it was rather remarkable, but in France, among the so-called intelligentsia, there was such a reaction against religion that Guénon didn't use the word religion in his books. He was afraid they wouldn't be read. He used the word tradition. And
what year are we speaking of?
We're speaking about, must have been in, I don't know the exact year, it must have been in 36 that I first read the books of Genel. I was 27 myself at that time. And my first thought was to give Genel's books to my friend, to Adrian Patterson, who shared my interests, and he had exactly the same impression that I had from the books, and he himself was determined to write it. My second thought was to give them to C.S. Lewis, but C.S. Lewis agreed with much of it. He hated the modern world. He saw that the modern world was completely wrong. But he had just rediscovered, having been an atheist, I didn't know this at the time, Lewis had just rediscovered Christianity. He was an Irishman from Northern Ireland. He had a great respect for Roman Catholicism. He lectured about the medieval life and thought in Europe, and especially in England, when everybody was a Roman Catholic. But he was a Protestant by upbringing and coming from the northern part of Ireland. And he just rediscovered Christianity for himself, having been an atheist. And he was too happy with that. He didn't want to be bothered by other religions. Mm. He wasn't interested in the books of Genel. That was a great disappointment to me. I thought that he would just have the same idea as myself, but he didn't. However, he did, I think he was influenced by them, by those books. Now, when I read the books of Genel, I gave up a great many things, including Shakespeare, because I thought to myself, well, now this is no longer part of your life. And I gave all my copies of Shakespeare. I had the Arden edition of Shakespeare, which is a very good edition. I think it's one of the best. It has the notes on the page. It's quite extensive notes, and the notes on the page. You don't have to look to turn over any pages. And it's very well produced. And I had the whole Arden edition. And I gave this to my sister. And I was looking for work myself. My father wanted me to be a barrister, and I was preparing to be a barrister. But then I realized after taking some bar exams that this was not for me. So I thought I would find work elsewhere. And I managed to get work in the University of Lithuania. I was teaching English, the English language, not literature, at the University of Kaunas. I didn't teach literature at all. My friend, Adrian Patterson, had become a lecturer in English literature at the University of Cairo. And he was teaching Shakespeare, amongst other things. But I was on a visit to my friend in Egypt in 1939, when the war broke out. And in the first days of the war, the way the way to Lithuania was blocked. I had my ticket booked. I think I was going by boat to Constanza on the Black Sea, and then by train to Bucharest, and then up north to Lithuania. But my way was blocked in the first days of the war, and I stayed in Egypt. Now, my friend died the following year from an accident. We were out riding together in the desert, and his horse ran away with him, and there was a fatal collision with a car. The horse was on the wrong side of the road and galloping at full speed, and my friend died the same day from loss of blood. And I was left there in Egypt, stranded, as it were. But then I was offered a post at the University of Egypt after some months. And then I was teaching Shakespeare. Found myself teaching Shakespeare.
And where was that? Your friend Adrian Patterson was at University of Cairo.
Cairo, yes.
And you were offered a position at University of Egypt.
University of Cairo, the same university.
The same one, okay.
I didn't have his place when he died. This was after his death in 1940. I wasn't fulfilling the gap left by him, but I was filling another gap. Mm. And then I was teaching Shakespeare. I asked my sister to send me as far as she could. I managed to get back my volumes of Shakespeare that I'd given my sister, because it was very important for me to have them. And I started teaching. And then the students, the Egyptians, are extremely good actors. And my friend had been asked by the students to produce them in some scenes of Shakespeare. And he did that, and he was very struck by the amazing natural ability that the Egyptians have for acting. And the students then began to pester me to produce a play at the university. And I finally consented to do that. And the plays were a success until finally, after some years, we took to producing the plays at the main theatre of Cairo, in the very centre of Cairo, and it became something of an event, our performance, and the diplomatic corps would attend. The British ambassador and his wife used to attend our plays, the French ambassador would attend the plays, and other members of the... And it became really quite an event, and we produced, amongst other things, some of the plays that are in this book. Well, we produced Hamlet, Othello, Macbeth. We didn't do King Lear. I would like to have done that. We did some of the earlier comedies like Twelfth Night and Midsummer Night's Dream. And we did Othello, in fact, twice. And it was amazing. The man who did the part of Othello was in both performances, was really excellent.
And were you in those productions attempting at all to bring out any of the deeper or esoteric allegorical side of Shakespeare?
No, that is a good question. The beginning, no, but my friend who had been teaching Shakespeare, Adrian Patterson, who died in 1940, said to me once, shortly before his death, "You know, I'm beginning to think that there is something really very serious in Shakespeare. There's a very profound meaning in Shakespeare." But he didn't say anything more than that. He didn't go into any details, and he wasn't concerned with... he was teaching the great plays, or some of them, but he wasn't... later on, my colleagues gave me all the Shakespeare teaching. They handed it over to me because it's more difficult than other things. It requires more work, and they were glad to be rid of it themselves. They preferred doing 18th century novels and that sort of thing. So I was left teaching the third and fourth years, that is the two final years of in the university. I was teaching all the Shakespeare for those years. And meantime, I had gone to Egypt to meet René Guénon, who was living in Egypt, in complete retirement from the world. And I said to him earlier on, after beginning to teach Shakespeare, you know, I'm beginning to think that there is a very profound significance in Shakespeare's plays. And he said, I always spoke French to him, because he didn't speak English. And he said, mais bien entendu. That means, but of course. I hadn't thought of that. I don't think he knew Shakespeare at all well, but he had come to that conclusion himself. He'd taken it for granted that Shakespeare is, in fact, the last outpost of the Middle Ages, you might say, in the beginning of the 17th century. He doesn't represent his time. He was himself, as I say, a kind of last outpost of the Middle Ages. But as you know, well, let me take just something I've said in the preface to this book. Shakespeare's greatness as an artist lies above all in the total impact that each of his best plays makes upon us when acted. But being a synthesis, this impact is not easily put into words, and once the curtain is down and we have left the theatre, what is said or written tends to do little justice to what we have experienced and seems unable to account for it. This book is much concerned with the mystery of the total impact, to which the subtitle, paraphrased from King Lear, is closely related. This is the new subtitle, To Take Upon Us the Mystery of Things. And this question is not without bearing on Shakespeare's greatness as a man. The greatness that we maintain is unmistakably visible through the semi-transparent veil of the plays.
Before we get too deeply ahead, for those who are thinking about it, what is it that you mean when you say sacred art? Because we're talking about these works of Shakespeare and others as being sacred art, and so what was it that you refer to as sacred art, and how do the plays and works of Shakespeare fall into that category of sacred art?
Yes, well, here again,